Every dance scene that has been featured in a Spike Lee film has had some sort of elaborate detail to it. Whether it's a couple dancing in a park or a packed ballroom in Harlem, it's clear that Lee holds affection for music and dance. He's incorporated scenes featuring one or two dancers performing a choreographed routine, entire groups of actors flooding a ballroom to swing dance, a select set of dancers to perform tap, as well as smaller groups of actors to improvise their dances. From the start of his career up to present day, Spike Lee's usage and fondness for dance sequences in his films have become a part of his auteur filmmaking style, but don't always hold narrative significance despite their sophistication. She's Gotta Have It was Lee's first feature-length film and the kickstart to his career. It's also where Lee's inclusion of dance sequences into his work begins. The dance sequence in She's Gotta Have It takes place in a park and focuses on two dancers, while two of the main characters, Nola Darling and Jamie, watch on. The park dance scene starts with Nola and Jamie in her apartment, as Nola clicks her heels saying, "There's no place like home." Then there's a sudden switch to the two of them in a park, and the film is in full color. The dance is captured through medium long shots and full body shots, with the camera tracking the dancers smoothly as they go back and forth, pulling apart before coming back together. This is the only part of the film that's not in black and white, and provides a nice change of pace that soon became a signature Lee technique. This dance sequence is more of a lighthearted and aesthetically pleasing sequence for the film, but it doesn't have a significant impact on the narrative. Released in 1989, Do the Right Thing is one of Lee's most critically acclaimed films of his career, and follows the story of a Brooklyn neighborhood as racial tensions rise on a hot summer day. The opening credits of this film is where the Fight the Power dance sequence starts. It features actress Rosie Perez doing a combination of punches and aggressive dance moves in front of a Brooklyn neighborhood backdrop, while Fight the Power by hip-hop group Public Enemy is playing in the background, which was requested specifically for this film by Lee, and it talks of the racial injustices that have been committed against the black community. Lee had Perez dance for about 8 hours while working on this scene, purposefully waiting for her to get angry at him in order to capture her raw emotion on camera. The Fight the Power dance sequence isn't so much for the narrative of the film, as it is a foreshadowing to the narrative itself, showing that the film will cover themes of racial injustice and the anger and destruction that can come from those injustices. Running on a budget of $6.5 million, School Days was released in 1988 to tell a story about colorism on a black college campus. There were tensions on the set of School Days, purposely roused up by Lee. He deliberately split his acting cast into two groups and placed them in separate hotels, giving one group better accommodations than the other. This gradually led to a fight to break out on set and for the two groups to have poor relations with each other, part of which can be seen in the Straight and Nappy number. The musical number Straight and Nappy in School Days features a semi-sophisticated dance sequence to contribute to the film's focus on colorism, while simultaneously portraying the women as merely an aesthetic to the men and their goals throughout the narrative. There are many musical numbers throughout the duration of School Days, but one number that sticks out in particular is the upbeat Straight and Nappy. The scene takes place in a hair salon and features a silver team composed of sorority girls, as well as a red team composed of girls who aren't in the sorority. The two teams argue about the decisions made to either stick with their natural African-American hair or style and treat it in order to fit in with modern white society. This scene partially contributes to the film's discussion on colorism through the eyes of the women on campus, and women are portrayed poorly not only in this scene, but within the film in general. The group of women dance around the salon in various taps, leaps, and twirls. They size each other up, corner each other into salon chairs to criticize their looks, and battle each other in synchronized dance lines. Throughout the narrative of School Days, the men and their goals dominate the campus, while the women are treated merely as an aesthetic to their plans. In fact, one of the first lines of the song is, "Don't you wish you had a hair like this, then the boys would give you a kiss," which goes to show that the women are basing their looks on what the men are going to like, and they use their appearances to side with either man whose political agenda they follow. What's even more important is that this scene, while brilliant in its content, dance, and execution, is not used or touched again for the remainder of the narrative. All in all, Straight and Nappy is a very charming number in School Days. The song is catchy and fun, the characters are clever and expressive, and the dance is show-stopping, but this number holds deeper significance and reveals that the characters exhibit colorism towards each other when they criticize their beauty choices and use racial slang when conversing with one another. This number also cements the women as visual aesthetics to the men in the narrative, having them only look like counterparts of the men while not allowing them to do anything that contributes to the goals of the characters. Malcolm X is a biopic covering the human rights activist and some of the most key parts of his life, while including scenes that lavishly revolve around African-American culture and dance. Lee's composition of the Showtime dance in Malcolm X through music, dance, costume, and cinematography depicts his admiration for sophisticated dance sequences with elaborate design that is reminiscent of Busby Berkeley. The Showtime dance starts off when Malcolm and Shorty are at the Roseland venue to dance and have a good time. When they get inside, the venue is full of dancers and a band, all dressed up in clothing from the time period and doing the Lindy Hop. Lee captures the dancing in the ballroom by using a crane, along with full body and close-up shots. The music featured during the Showtime dance is 1930s and 40s style swing music, which originated around the start of the 1930s and became widely popular in a short amount of time with this connection to the Lindy Hop. Swing music and dance also had the ability to bring groups of different classes and ethnicities together. Swing music and the Lindy Hop became widely popular at the Savoy Ballroom in Harlem and tended to ease racial tensions when everyone was simply out having fun on the dance floor. The dancing style of the Showtime scene in Malcolm X is a captivating and charming viewing experience. In an article written by Christopher J. Wells, the Lindy Hop is an African-American dance form that originated in the late 1920s through a blend of dances like the Charleston and the Collegiate, and became popular amongst the youth in ballroom settings in Harlem throughout the 30s and 40s. He also mentions that a man known as Shorty George Snowden is often credited as the creator of the Lindy Hop, and that he also had a partner named Big B. It's possible that Lee may have tried to pay homage to that part of African American culture in this dance sequence through his own character Shorty and the women he dances with for the scene. The dance itself is fairly reminiscent of the kaleidoscope-type productions that film director Busby Berkeley would put on, with the dancers making use of the steps up to the stage to move in patterns as well as semi-organized lines on the dance floor. The costume design for this dance sequence is another part of what makes the Showtime scene so captivating to watch. All of the characters are wearing clothes that swing dancers in the 30s and 40s would have worn, such as knee-length dresses with flowing skirts and loose suits in vibrant colors that stand out on the dance floor. The aesthetics of this scene pay homage to independent race films of the 30s and 40s, showcasing how Lee found ways to connect his film to African-American film history and how he paid attention to stylistic detail. Lee makes use of large, extreme long shots to show the venue packed with people, which allows the audience to get swept up in the fun of watching the dancers spin and fly across the ballroom floor. It's in this scene that it is shown how Lee takes on a Berkeley-esque design, because Berkeley made use of the same camera techniques to show off his dancers and capture the large scope of his choreography. Lee's composition of the Showtime dance sequence in Malcolm X is one to be marveled at. The complexity and rich culture that comes with the music, dance, and costumes featured in this scene reflect Lee's attention to detail, and especially his adoration for sophisticated dance numbers. It is also an exceptional example of how his fondness for those dances have become a part of his auteur style as a director, leaving audiences mesmerized. One of Lee's most poorly received films was released towards the end of the 20th century and looks back on the painful history of blackface and minstrelsy in media. It also encourages audiences to heed caution with representation in the new century as media continues to grow and evolve in our society. Bamboozled is a satirical comedy-drama film about the creation of a modern minstrel television show, its rise in popularity, and its violent blowout. It is also a strong warning about the lasting effects of racially degrading representation throughout media history. Through the use of several captivating tap dance sequences in Bamboozled, Lee shares his concerns regarding black entertainment and the use of minstrelsy in media. Bamboozled encompasses the rise and fall of a minstrel show created by an ambitious and formally educated African-American man named Pierre Delacroix, and the negative effect it takes on those participating in it. The main performers of the minstrel show are two young African-American men known as Man Ray and Womack, who are first introduced near the start of the film as they leave the building they're squatting in to go perform on the street in front of the CNS television headquarters, where Delacroix works. The two are natural performers, with Man Ray doing the dancing and Womack using his charisma to draw in a crowd and persuade them to donate money, even Delacroix, whom they know. Lee alternates between clips of Man Ray's feet and his full body in motion as he dances in front of the crowd, while letting the diegetic sound of the film draw the audience into the rhythmic dance as well, making it seem effortless. It's through this first tap dance that Lee not only shows the importance of hard work that African-American performers put into their craft, but he goes against the old Hollywood technique of intercutting shots of the tap dancers' feet with close-ups of their wide, toothy smiles, resulting in a biased archive of dance footage. The second tap dance performance occurs in Dunwoody's office, who happens to be Delacroix's boss. Dunwoody is a white, obnoxious man who is oblivious to his racist demeanor and is all too comfortable using racial slurs. Delacroix pitches the New Millennium Minstrel Show as his idea and recruits Man Ray and Womack as the two stars, who are to act as coons known as Mantan and Sleepindeed. Following his pitch, Delacroix has Man Ray do a small tap performance on top of Dunwoody's conference table. Dunwoody watches him in wonder and is clearly entertained the whole time, but the objectification of African-American performers for white audiences is called on here. While the tap dancing is captivating to watch, it descends from a mix of cultures, as well as vaudeville, and its growth of popularity in the preceding minstrel show comes at the cost of using slavery as a source of humor, as well as the degradation of Man Ray and Womack as they take part in the project. One of the most important performances throughout the duration of Bamboozled is the tap dance during the minstrel show. Before the show even begins, Manray and Womack are shown backstage as they transform themselves into Mantan and Sleepyneat through the use of blackface. Blackface is considered to be the most hostile and racist depiction of blackness, simply because blackface was primarily donned by white folk back in the early days of vaudeville and the film industry. This holds greater significance in Bamboozled because of the fact that Manray and Womack are expected to wear blackface despite being African American. This minstrelsy is not only emphasized by the credits sequence at the end of the film, but it is also emphasized as the New Millennium Minstrel Show carries on. The dancers are dressed in various negative racial stereotypes, like coons, bucks, and mammies. The dances leave strong reminder to audiences that the humiliating and degrading representation of African Americans for the entertainment of others can have negative lasting effects, and that it should not be repeated as new media is created. From the beginning to the end, Lee uses the tap routines in Bamboozled to call on the history of African-American tap dancing and the negative representation the performers have had in media. Bamboozled is a reminder of how African-American tap dancing started during slavery but became popular in vaudeville. It is also a reminder of how the performers have been objectified, made fun of, and used for the enjoyment of others. And the use of satire in the film is a way of calling out the history of minstrelsy without having to bear the full weight of the trauma that stemmed from it. Released in 2018, Black Klansman is one of Lee's most recent films and focuses on the story of Ron Stallworth, a black police officer who successfully infiltrated the Ku Klux Klan chapter in Colorado Springs by telephone during the 70s. The club dance scene featured in Black Klansman has a different tone than the dances featured in some of Lee's previous films. It's less of a show and more of a close and intimate experience. Stallworth invites Patrice to get a drink with him at a club after attending a local civil rights rally, and he takes her out on the dance floor as a way of comforting her after hearing that she was harassed by one of the white officers from his department on the way to the club. The club is packed with 70s decorations, a slew of dancing bodies, and dim lighting in hues of red, orange, and yellow. Stallworth and Patrice join everyone on the dance floor, who are dancing in close proximity with their arms raised and moving slowly in sync. The camera captures the space between the people and their dancing through medium close-ups and close-ups, as well as by being within the crowd instead of being placed outside of it. This dance is more to create a close and charming atmosphere of black character and culture from the 70s, instead of being used to provide deep narrative significance to the rest of the film. The dance sequences used throughout Lee's film career has resulted in a vast collection of scenes that are culturally and historically rich, and have contributed to his auteur film style, whether or not they had an impact on the film narratives that they were featured in. She's Gotta Have It was the start for Lee's inclusion of dance sequences into his work. The park dance scene was a fairly sophisticated dance that consisted of a synchronized pair, but it offered no substantial impact to the narrative itself. Do the Right Thing featured Rosie Perez dancing alone to fight the power by Public Enemy, a song about racial injustice. While not wholly elaborate in its dance, the scene foreshadows the themes of the film, like racial injustice and anger, but doesn't have any impact on the narrative itself. The Straight and Nappy dance scene in School Days was a sophisticated and long sequence, featuring female dancers tapping and twirling through a hair salon. Straight and Nappy covered themes of colorism and beauty imagery, but the narrative doesn't expand on them for the rest of the film. Malcolm X is a prime example of Lee's admiration for sophisticated dance sequences, especially within the Showtime dance scene. The venue and costumes for the scene were large scale. It featured the cultural significance and impact of African American music and dance during the 30s and 40s, and it also paid homage to independent race films. While it didn't contribute much to the narrative of Malcolm X, the scene was important in culture and stylistic choices. Bamboozled consisted of dance sequences that were important both historically and to the narrative, and they also gradually grew in their sophistication as the film progressed. The dances contributed to the narrative by showing how the tap dancing for the minstrel show eventually led to a violent blowout. They also recounted how African American tap dancing was rooted in slavery and how harmful minstrelsy and negative representation of black performers in media can be. Finally, the club dance sequence in Black Klansman is a continuation of Lee's usage of dance in his work. The scene is sophisticated in its set design and camera work, but it is not over the top in composition, nor is it entirely used for the narrative. Lee may continue to incorporate sophisticated dance sequences into his future films, and it's a possibility that they may continue to be put in purely for style. But the dances he has captured so far have been nothing short of a phenomenal experience.